Good afternoon. My name is Matt Garbark. I'm the acting director of the Department of Public Works for the City of Baltimore. On March 19th, Mayor Young declared a state of emergency due to COVID-19. On March 23rd, DPW shut down all operations other than routine trash and recycling collections, landfill operations, and corner can collections. As the pandemic progressed and more people began staying at home, we saw an increase in trash tonnage of over 20%. To assist in handling this increased volume, we began seeking contract support in April and obtained emergency approval to move forward with contracts without the need to competitively bid. We received little to no interest from contractors despite our attempts. In May, we began bringing all solid waste operations back online, and employees returned to begin addressing a growing list of service requests. It was in mid-May that we began getting reports of COVID cases at our Eastside Sanitation Yard on Bowley's Lane. By early June, we had nearly 30 employees at the Eastside Yard out due to infection or self-isolation, and all of the Eastside supervisors were out as well. On June 10th, we suspended all Eastside operations as well as citywide recycling collection for a period of 3 weeks to disinfect and to allow all employees to quarantine. During that time, our Westside Yard as well as workers from our other divisions had to collect all the trash throughout the city. This led to a serious problem with missed routes, lack of clarity on routes, and supervisor confusion. We also saw employees begin to call out and refuse to show up. We once again aggressively sought to obtain contractors to supplement our services, but there was still little to no interest. We brought everyone back to work the week of July 4th and resumed operations. On July 17th, we experienced another outbreak among our employees at the Quarantine Road landfill. We sent all but a few employees home to self-isolate and close the landfill for 2 days. It was at that time that one of our strong partners, construction contractor R.E. Harrington, stepped up and offered assistance in operating the landfill while our employees were in isolation. They did so without further interruption to landfill operations. The threat of COVID and the potential exposure our employees have given their public-facing jobs has remained a serious fear. More importantly, this July has set a record for the hottest month in Maryland history. It also set a 148-year record on number of days in a month with temperatures at or above 90 degrees. So as we moved through July, we had increased tonnage, our workers were afraid and anxious, and the heat was oppressive. Routes started getting longer and we began seeing more and more employees go out on medical leave or injury due to heat-related illness. Our employees are also required to wear masks at all times, which restricts breathing and can increase heat-related illness as well. Our crews were quite simply exhausted. Getting into August, this trend continued, as did the heat. More and more people began calling out. Because trash collection is a significant public health issue, we have had to redirect recycling crews to trash collection. This has led to missed recycling routes. Crews begin the next day on the recycling routes that were not completed the day before. As the number of missed routes grows, we have been unable to make up collections the next day. The backlog has become so significant that it has taken days or sometimes over a week to make up the missed collection routes. Trash and recycling collections occur Tuesday through Friday. Each day, we have about 70 collection routes, give or take. Around 50 of them are trash routes and 20 of them are recycling routes. For each route, there are 3 workers required, 1 driver and 2 laborers. So we need at a very minimum 210 workers just to simply operate as crews out collecting trash and recycling. What we really need is 230, including the supervisors, the superintendents, and other support staff. Over the past few weeks, we have been averaging 150 to 160 employees per day. On some days, we have had nearly 80 people either call out or are no longer able to work because of medical leave due to injury or illness. This past weekend, we were behind by 49 recycling routes on Friday. We wanted to make them up on Saturday, but we only had enough employees to collect 21 of those routes. On Monday, looking to finish this backlog, we had only enough employees to collect 6 of those routes. This means 27 uncollected routes had to be collected before we even began this week's normal collection. We have constantly been seeking contractors to this day and have only gotten 2 to commit so far to just a handful of routes per day. The reasons for this are complicated. First, there is a national shortage of solid waste workers for exactly the reasons I've outlined. It is a community-oriented job that does pose challenges for the elements as well as possible exposure to COVID. Another major issue, and one of the critical issues, is the size of the vehicles. We have specialized vehicles that are smaller than the normal vehicles that contractors use. Contractors don't have these vehicles, and they cannot fit down our narrow streets and alleys. In fact, we asked the contractors if they had the vehicles, would they be able to go down the alleys, and they have refused. They said that because of safety and liability concerns, they would not go down our alleys due to possible safety and liability risks of the narrow and confined spaces. As a result, we have had to find routes where trash can be collected from the front on the street side of residences rather than the back. This has added more logistical issues that we've had to consider. To bring the severity of the crisis into focus, we lost a worker, Mr. Donald Savoy, on Tuesday while he was on his route. He was a 12-year veteran employee in solid waste who was truly respected and admired by his colleagues. We don't know all of the details, but this highlights the challenges our men and women in solid waste face each and every day. He will be truly missed, and we are certainly mourning his loss. We've reached a breaking point. Mr. John Chalmers, Bureau Head of Solid Waste, has worked for the city for the past 30 years. He has experience in all aspects of the operation and is truly the city's leader when it comes to trash and recycling collection. I asked John on Tuesday if we are still able to collect trash and recycling each day. His answer was no. As the issues have continued to accumulate, Mayor Young directed us to develop a plan to ensure trash is collected in a timely and consistent manner. Today, I'm announcing our solid waste continuity of service plan, which is consistent with the mayor's directive. Effective Monday, August 31st, all recycling collection crews will be diverted to trash collection on a full-time basis. Unfortunately, this means recycling operations must be modified. While this plan is in effect, recycling will no longer be collected from residences. That being said, we must do what we can to encourage recycling and waste diversion. Our recently released long-term operational plan, Less Waste, Better Baltimore, makes these commitments to waste diversion and reuse abundantly clear. That is why we will be establishing community collection centers for recycling in each of the 14 city council districts. These will be locations where residents can come to drop off their recycling. The centers will consist of a roll-off dumpster or a trash vehicle and will be open in operation from Monday through Friday, 7 a.m. to 3 p.m. Two of these centers include the Citizen Convenience Centers located at our West Side Yard on Reedburg Avenue and our East Side Yard on Bowley's Lane. They will be fully reopened for both trash and recycling operations. These are in addition to our currently open convenience centers at the Northwest Transfer Station, another located on Sisson Street, and the last being at the Quarantine Road landfill. We've also begun looking at innovative ways to find contract support since we've been having challenges. We are contracting out our condominium and apartment operations, which will free up around 5 drivers. Additionally, our construction contractor, R. E. Harrington, has once again offered to have laborers and drivers come work our routes with our crews and drive our trash vehicles. We're currently working through potential legal and risk issues with that, but I think we're getting that solved. We are also working with our sister agencies, the Department of Transportation and indeed the Fire Department, as they have many CDL drivers. We are actively seeking any of the city employees who have CDL drivers and are willing to get overtime to come and drive our routes. Finally, we are standing up a solid waste command center located at our park terminal facility. Here, we will monitor the community collection centers, direct relief, or disposal throughout the day as needed, and we will also be monitoring daily operations and developing informative and regular communications updates to share with the public by social media. The continuity of service plan will remain in effect until at least November 1st. We will be monitoring daily operations, and we are truly hoping everything will stabilize before that so that we can return to normal operations sooner than November 1st. Throughout this pandemic, as Baltimore has faced crisis after crisis, our residents have come together to support each other. We are asking that you continue to do so during this time and look out for your neighborhood and your neighbors to ensure we have a clean city. We believe this plan, while difficult, is what is needed for us to gain control of this crisis and to ensure consistent and effective collections. Thank you for your time, and I'm happy to answer any questions. Question was, what criteria we use to restart the program? Very basically, we are going to start looking at the number of routes each day. We need to make sure we collect all the trash routes each and every day. We also need to start looking at trends for who we have available on a given basis so that we can get up to a 210 to 230 number that we can sustain full operations. And once we see a trend of that, we're looking at what that time frame would be, but once we see a trend of that, that'll help indicate whether we resume normal operations.
Do you have a budget to hire additional solid waste workers?
What we are actually doing is we are looking at cost containment internally. We've already had to do some of that for the budget situation. We are also looking at other areas where we can sort of squeeze out more money if we can. At this point, the additional costs for contractors, we've been advised, are reimbursable as a COVID expense. So the city is is thinking that we will get most of those costs reimbursed by the federal government. Yes, constantly. I'm going to ask Mr. Chalmers to address that point.
Good afternoon, everyone. So our property management and public right-of-way cleaning crews are up and running. We are addressing those service requests as they come in. We do the heavy lifting as it relates to illegal dumping. We don't do the enforcement piece. That piece is handled through the housing code development. They manage that. But we are actively cleaning lots and alleys and public right of way.
So people who are dumping, not only can't get rid of the trash, but they're dumping and not even taking the dump site, the waste site. Yeah. So we did a story in Westport, which the dump site is just down the street.
Right.
But they dumped it before they even get there because of fines, not fines, but
Right. So that's, you know, that's kind of troubling. As Acting Director Matt Garbar just referenced, we have 5 citizen drop-off locations throughout the city. These citizen drop-off locations are free to city residents. There's no need to dump. We have one located right there at 701 Rebird, if we're talking about the Curtis Bay area, which is, you know, not even a mile away. So there are options for folks other than dumping. And there's also the Quarantine Road Landfill, which is another convenience center on the other side of Curtis Bay, which is, you know, not even a mile away. These are the behaviors that we have to work on as a city to change and let folks know that there are other options as opposed to dumping in the city.
I'm sorry, say that again. Currently, there is a timeline on contracts. We are working on 1-year contracts. That is the minimum that contractors are asking for them to actually commit services. So there would be a 1-year contract to supplement services. And one of the issues that we are seeing is that the pricing is variable. Different contractors have different rates and are offering different services. We are under emergency approval, so as soon as there is an agreement on price and terms, they can begin immediately.
Yes. So, as the acting director just stated, we're going to set up a command center to monitor all of 14 locations that we're setting up. We're also going to have folks stationed at those locations to monitor and make sure that the right materials go into those containers. We're going to use this as an opportunity as well to educate folks on the do's and don'ts of recycling. Recycle right. We're going to be passing out material at these 14 locations.
So, no, it's at, no, thank, good question. The question was about the issues with the contractors and concerns of going down alleys. Many Baltimore City alleys are 11 feet wide. The smallest load packer, which is what our vehicle is called, is, I believe, what, 9 feet?
9.5 feet
wide. That leaves mere inches on either side. In addition, you have utility poles located there. Half the time, there's gates and alleys that are open. Cars haven't pulled all the way into their parking pad. So there is a backing up and constant maneuvering around things. Also, in some of our neighborhoods, particularly in South Baltimore, the load packer can only get in one way. They actually have to then back out. My understanding is the contractors, they work very quickly. They want to get as much trash picked up as quickly as they can, and this just became too much of a risk for them to consider. Citywide.
And is there a goal as to when residents can expect that service to continue?
This plan is in effect until November 1st. We hope it will be before that, but right now it's going to be November 1st. We want to ensure that we have ample opportunity to recover and stabilize operations.
So we've been monitoring those numbers very closely throughout the entire pandemic, and we really have not seen a spike in those numbers. We've had our rat abatement program up and running for the most part during this entire time. I think we suspended for about maybe 2-3 weeks. But other than that, proactive rat abatement teams have been on the street working. I'd just like to add one thing to the director's comment. The mixed refuse operation The drivers that work for us on the city side of the house, they spend most of their day backing up. And there's a big difference on the private side. The private side, they spend most of the day driving forward. So it's not that simple to get somebody to jump into one of our trucks and navigate these tight, tight alleys. You know, that's why we assign a driver and labor to a specific route. They get to know the route, all the nuances in the route, how to maneuver that route. Without that, you're gonna have increase in injuries, property damage, and that's what we're trying to avoid.
I just wanna make one last point to your question a little bit ago about dumping and overall street and alley collections. What we've been having to do, given all of these issues, is pull workers from these other services, which has then left those services unattended. So by doing this, we are shoring up our routine operations and allowing those other workers to continue with those critical services of street and alley cleaning, as well as rat abatement and everything else. So we're hoping that all of those will start stabilizing as well as a result of this. So there's going to be 14, one in each Council Manic district. We will be constantly monitoring the use of these, the effectiveness of these. We are talking to local officials and community members, and if there is a desire or need that they be moved somewhere else, we will certainly do that. But I will say this, if whatever is left out, whether it is in a yellow can or a trash can, will be collected by our trash crews.
You mentioned that there's some anxiety with a lot of crews. I think a lot of people in the city are sympathetic that things have been given to the public service. Is DPW getting, you know, DPD, sanitation supplies, wallets, or to kind of quell that anxiety to make workers feel like they're helping to
report? Certainly. It's a great point. The question was about what we're doing to help address some of the worker anxiety and fear. We have, Department of Public Works has purchased the largest amount of personal protective equipment out of any agency in the city, by and large. We have never run out of masks, we have never run out of gloves, and we are always in supply of hand sanitizer and other things to ensure that people are protected. We are also ensuring that people have proper breaks, that they are out and about and not confined to a vehicle too long, so that they don't potentially expose one another. But at the end of the day, the nature of the job is very community oriented, and you are touching and maneuvering and utilizing things that belong to someone else that you don't always know what is on them. We have insisted and are being very strict about our crews using the lift arms, which are intended to lift the green cans to actually dump the trash so that they don't have to actually touch the trash. One of the issues with recycling is we don't have that. So they would actually have to physically remove the recycling or the cart. And that also was a touch point that we're going to be avoiding, at least for this period of time. Yeah, it's too early to know that.